Hello, I'm Liao. In the last video, we started to talk about words that probably we're going to use throughout learning SvelteKit. And those words like client-side rendering, server-side rendering, hydration, browser navigation, prefetching, those words not just applies to SvelteKit, it also applies to any other frameworks that you're going to use out there. In the last video, we start to talk about client-side rendering and server-side rendering. Basically, we explain what is the meaning of it and the concept behind it. And in this video, we're going to talk about something very important that bridges between the server-side rendering and client-side rendering. And you're right, we're going to talk about hydration. So what is hydration? Let's take a look. Before I start to talk about hydration, probably I can share with you a story behind the history of web development, right? Basically when I was young, right? I'm not too old right now, but when I was young, computers and browsers weren't as powerful as they are right now. Most websites have limited interactivity. Most websites did server-side rendering. So meaning when you visit a site, when you check the network, the server returns a full HTML of how the site looks like. And sometimes when you need some interactivity, like the site that we are seeing right now, we have two buttons and a value. You send some JavaScript along the site to the HTML to add that interactivity. So what is in that JavaScript code? Well, it needs to find the two buttons and a span. So in the server-side rendered HTML, usually those elements will be added with an ID attribute to make it easy for the JavaScript code to find them, right? And in our JavaScript code, what we can do is we find those elements, right? We use getElementById to find them out, and then we add event listeners so that when click, we can modify the span value. Notice that in this case, the code to generate the HTML that we saw, like the server-side rendering, server-side rendered code, it's quite separate from the code that you see right here, which is to modify a DOM, right? You have two sets of code. What happens if you accidentally made an alteration, like modify the ID on the server-side rendered code like this, then on the client-side code, probably it will break because you couldn't find ID button 1. Just hold this thought. We're not going to go through practices on how we can prevent this from happening in this video, but this is just more of a food for thought. So as we learn about how powerful browser can be, we start to build more interactive websites. Something that looks like this. We have, when you click on images, it pops up like a slideshow and like image lightbox where you can slide and next, and then you can close the image preview, right? So if you can see here, the arrow button, the close button, the backdrop, all this probably is rendered on the client side, right? The server probably just returns the three images. So you start to have more mishmash of content that's either coming from the server side or client side. So eventually one day someone decided that why not just not do anything, not send any HTML, just send an empty HTML with a script tag from the server side and do everything on the client side. And that goes with a generation of web frameworks to help you to just do just that. Right, one thing we have gained along the way is that the code to generate the HTML and the code to add interactivity now fuses to become ones because everything is done on the client side now, right? So it allows you to write codes like this, right? So since the framework is creating the elements themselves, unlike what we had previously, we don't need ID to find what the elements, where the element is and attach event listeners, right? Since we create them together. So now the framework does all of them together and we already have the reference of the elements that we just created, so we can immediately attach event listeners. As more and more sites move towards fully client-side rendering, you start to feel that the sites are a bit slow. So because these websites ship down an empty HTML, so when we visit this website and when it feels that the whole website has been loaded, we still see a blank screen. Because at this point of time, the browser will still have to download the JavaScript, parse them and execute them. So only when those JavaScript are ready, then only you start to see the content. So someone starts to question this. It wasn't like this previously, right? Previously, we visit the site when the page is like fully loaded, we already see content. But what happened? have we done something wrong by rendering everything on the client side? Of course, like what we had previously, of course, it's not like instantaneously the server returns a response. We'll still take some time because the work of rendering the content still has to be done somewhere, which is to be done on the server side, right? It's just that it feels faster because once it's loaded, the whole contentful site is ready on your screen instead of a blank page. So since we've written our application using modern web frameworks, instead of rewriting another set of code on the server side, this modern framework starts to support server-side rendering, enabling us to reuse the same piece of code that you see over here to render both on the server side and the client side. So the modern web framework playbook now is like this. When you visit the site, we serve the content through server-side rendering, right? The first initial load is from the server side. And as we start to interact with the site, then we modify the DOM, modify the content through the client-side rendering. So with more concise front-end lingo, this is called initial render on the server side and continue on the client side. So how does the framework allow us to do that, right? We just write one piece of code, right? So how does the framework do? So instead of having the client-side code to create all the elements from scratch, we try to reuse the elements that's being created from the server-side rendering, right? So the server-side rendering returns HTML, which pass and creates DOM. So we just reuse those elements instead of creating new elements, right? So basically, we go through the same process of client-side rendering, except when the time of creating DOM elements, we checked on the DOM to see whether if the elements is already there, so we can reuse. If not, we're going to create it. Whether we reuse or create elements, now we get hold of the reference of the elements. And with that, we can attach event listeners, just like how we did on the client-side rendering. This process of claiming or reusing elements from the server-side rendering and attaching event listeners is called hydration. And sometimes it's called rehydration. But why is it called hydration? Well, I look around on the internet and I found someone explained this on a Stack Overflow using pizza as a metaphor. Imagine server-side rendered content is a dehydrated pizza from the Back to Future 2. It is the full pizza. It has all the contents you need, cheese and all that. However, it's dried. It's not for consumption for normal users yet. It's not interactive at all. So we rehydrate the pizza, trying to restore the pizza to its full and tasty states by adding water or the event listeners in our case. And now we have a rehydrated pizza, nice and tasty and fully interactive. So hydration. In the current generation of hydration, we do everything like a client-side rendering, except that instead of creating nodes, you reuse existing nodes. So you can think of hydration as a mode of client-side rendering. If the mode is on, we reuse or create the nodes elements if we can't find it. And if that hydration mode is off, then it's just client-side rendering. So we create elements. So it's the same piece of code, but able to do two things. One small thing to point out is that if you look closely in the hydration mode, we reuse or create, meaning there's a sense of repairing the content, right? If we can't reuse, we can't find the DOM elements that we can reuse, then we create one. So if the server side does not return or renders anything at all, we can still hydrate and create those elements out. So this mental model feels like it's always client side first. Irrelevant if the server side returns anything or wrong HTML, you still repair them on the client side. Client side is a source of truth. So however, some may argue that this approach to hydration is inefficient, especially when you have a lot of static elements like this. Mentally, you know that the goal of hydration is to find the button and add event listeners. But if you look at the actual operations of hydration, we still go through all the logic of the components, attempt to find and reuse H1, H2, div tag. And doing this probably have like zero effect to the DOM, right? Because you find them, yeah, that's great. So it's there, nothing changed. So there's an effort to actually looking into ways to improve on this front. But before we go into that, let me show you some examples so that you don't think that this is an easy fit. what if you have a component that has some logics, like the template has some logics inside? In this case, we have like if condition. So the hydration code has to know all the state values that was being used in the server side. Before we can continue hydration, we do need to know what is the condition, what is the value, so that we know that whether the server returns us only one button, that we need to hydrate only one button, or we need to hydrate two buttons, right? And whether the event listeners is to increment or double or to decrement. We love to use components to compose our application. So if you have something like look like this, you look through, we have an app that uses a foo, then we have foo that uses a bar, and we pass value from app to foo to bar all the way. And if you look at the server-side rendered code, you probably just see a button that you just need to attach event listeners. However, to know what is the value that it is right now and how to increment that, we basically have to reconstruct the whole application, all the component structure from top to bottom, from app to foo to bar. Right? Even though app and foo has zero effect to the final DOM and to the behavior at all. So what's next for us? So we have a few approaches that is currently trying out to improve this. Say one way is to break down the application to smaller islands, and we choose islands that are interactive to hydrate when we interact with them, right? So that we don't have to rehydrate the whole entire application. There's effort also to try to differentiate our components into client-side components or server-side components, so that we only hydrates the parts or renders the parts that is client-side rendered, right? And skip through the server-side rendered components. Or we can hydrate, or better put, resumes interactive parts of your code when there's interaction, right? So we're not using the word hydration, because generally hydration refers to recreate the entire application and reuse elements. In this case, we try to only find interactable elements and only load codes to add interactivity when we try to interact with those elements. So there's a lot of efforts that's put into this front, and who knows what lies ahead of us. But I believe the future is bright, and we are gonna keep exploring. And so that's it about hydration. I hope you learned about what is hydration, what does it do, the concept behind it, and why do some people think is inefficient, and what is the future for hydration. If you like this video, give me a huge thumbs up. If you have any questions, feel free to comment in the description below, or join us at our Discord channel server to jump in and talk with all other subscribers of this channel. And I shall see you in the next video. So see ya, bye bye.